The Lord is good. We will never forget that you are good. We will never forget that we owe you praise because you're God. Because you're God. You alone are worthy. Oh, come on, Zion. Let's set the atmosphere this morning. For our God is one Lord. Hallelujah. There's no other God. There's no other God beside him. There's no other God but him. Hallelujah. And you're the one that we serve. You're the one that we love. You're the one that we pray to. Hallelujah. Thank you for answering our prayers. Thank you for guiding us over this weekend. Over this weekend. Thank you, Lord God, for everything that you do. Everything that you are. We love you. We love you, Jesus. We love you, Jesus. We love you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you for your presence, Lord. Hallelujah. Our scripture this morning, thank you, Jesus. It's coming from Psalms 34. Mm-hmm. Thank you, Lord. It says, I will bless the Lord at all times.
Yes.
His praise shall continually be in my mouth. My soul shall make her boast in the Lord. The humble shall hear thereof and be glad. Oh, magnify the Lord with me, and let us exalt his name together. One more verse. I sought the Lord, and he heard me, and delivered me from all of my fears. Hallelujah. May the Lord add a blessing to the reading of his word. Anybody glad to be in the house this morning? Hallelujah. Come on, Zion. Are you happy to be here? Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. What a mighty God we serve. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this beautiful day. Father, we just take a moment in Selah and just reflect on who you are and how good you've been on this week. Father, someone didn't make it through the week, but Lord, we're here, not because of our own selves or our own strength or our own wit, but because of your grace and your mercy. Father, we thank you that someone may be struggling this morning, but we thank you that you are the lifter of our heads. Father, someone may have pain on this morning, but you are the healer of our bodies. So, Father, we just lift up each other this morning, and we commit this service into your hand. Thank you, Lord God, for having your way in this place on today. Those that are watching online, we thank you for a special blessing for them as well. Those that want to be here and cannot be here, we ask, Lord God, that your Holy Spirit would move in the room where they are. I pray, Lord God, in the name of Jesus, that you touch our pastor. We thank you for our wonderful bishop, and we thank you, Lord God, for bringing healing in his body continually. We thank you for anointing him afresh as he delivers the word. Father, we just come against every power of the enemy that would try to attack the man of God, as well as our shepherd mother. We thank you for the victory that comes through Jesus Christ our Lord. Father, we thank you, Lord God, for everyone who is maybe going through challenges this morning. Father, let that not stop our praise. Let nothing hinder our worship on this morning, because despite anything else, you're still worthy. You're still God, and you still deserve your accolades. So, Father, we've come to honor you this morning, and we lift you up, and we celebrate you. And, Father, your word says that for the spirit of heaviness to put on the garment of praise. So, Father, as we praise you, we thank you that chains are falling off. As we praise you, we thank you that evil spirits are being dismissed in the name of Jesus. And we praise you and we honor you for being God. Have your way is our prayer. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Zion, clap your hands. Clap your hands if you love Jesus. And I'm convinced that you do. Come on, don't patty cake him, but give him a worthy hand clap this morning. Chris, I need your help. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Song says, I command my soul to bless the Lord. Anybody came to bless him this morning?
Yeah.
Let's celebrate together. Hey. Everybody clap.
Woo.
Put a smile on your face. You're in the presence of the Lord. I command my soul to bless the Lord.
I command my soul to bless the Lord.
I command my soul to bless the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
my soul to bless the Lord.
I command my soul to bless the Lord.
I command my soul to bless the Lord. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Soul, 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 soul. Bless the Lord.
Soul,
soul, soul. Bless the Lord. Soul, soul. Bless the Lord.
I command my soul to bless the Lord.
Come on, you got it.
I command my soul to bless the Lord.
I command my soul to bless the Lord.
Say hallelujah.
I command my soul to bless the Lord.
Yeah, command my soul to bless the Lord.
Come on. I command my soul to bless the Lord.
Say hey,
hallelujah. Soul, soul, bless the Lord. Soul, soul, bless the Lord. Soul, soul, bless the Lord. Soul, soul, bless the Lord.
I command my feet to leap for joy.
I command my feet to leap for joy.
I command my feet to leap for joy. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
I command my soul to bless the Lord.
I command my soul to bless the Lord.
I command my soul to bless the Lord. Hey.
Hallelujah. Soul, soul, bless the Lord.
Hey.
Soul, soul, bless the Lord.
Come on.
Soul, soul, bless the Lord. Soul, soul, bless the Lord.
I command my feet to leap for joy. Come on.
I command my feet to leap for joy.
I command my feet to leap for joy. Hey,
hallelujah.
I command my voice to sing his praise. Hey,
I command my voice to sing his praise.
Hey, I command my voice.
Beat, beat, beat for joy. Ooh, beat.
leap for joy. Leap, leap.
One more time.
Leap for joy.
Let's
the Lord.
You're the Lord of the Lord. We honor you, Jesus. We honor you. It's all about you. It's all about you. Get your glory. Get the glory. Get the glory. Out of our lives. Get the glory. As we praise you. As we worship. You get the glory. You get the glory. You get the glory. Bless the Lord. In your heart, with all your might, with all your strength, you deserve it. Bless the Lord. You deserve it. Bless the Lord. We're holding nothing. We're holding nothing. We'll give it to you. We'll give it to you. Bless the Lord. Cause you're strong, you can do it. Anything, yeah. You can do it. God, come on, Zion, clap your hands. If you know he's worthy, hallelujah, I will bless the Lord. I will bless the Lord. I will bless the Lord. It's an act of my will. I will myself to do it because I know he's worthy. Anybody know you owe him a praise this morning? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. For being such a faithful God. You're such a faithful God. Such a faithful God. You provided for us. You covered us. Thank you for the blood of Jesus. Thank you for the blood of Jesus. Thank you for the blood of Jesus. Cleanses us. Changes us. Covers us.
Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Bless your name.
We worship in the house that praise built. We build God a house of praise, and he inhabits the praise of his people. And then we can sit with him and worship, set his feet and worship him. Hallelujah. Before we sing another song, would you just confess your love for Jesus? Just tell the Lord you love him. Hallelujah. And keep saying it until something happens in your spirit. Hallelujah. This morning our theme is our soul. Hallelujah. Our soul loves you, Jesus. Our soul loves you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Come on, Zion, open up your mouth if you're able to. And just begin to give the Lord accolades. Communicate with him and let him know you appreciate him for being God in your life. Hallelujah. You can tell him thank you. You can give him hallelujah. That's the highest praise. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Hallelujah. It comes from our soul, a heart that's grateful. Gratitude comes from inside. Lord God, thank you. Thank you, Lord Jesus. It could have been so different. Thank you, Lord, for your hand on us. Thank you for your hand on our families. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for covering our hearts. Thank you, Lord God, for being the lifter of our heads. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Come on, come on. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. The song is not the song with the melody. It's the melody of your heart. It's your heart's cry this morning. Father, we're grateful. We're grateful. We're grateful. Hallelujah. We don't deserve anything but death for our sins, Lord God. And you blessed us. Hallelujah. We're blessed. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah.
soul will sing. Hallelujah. Oh, my soul will sing. Hallelujah. 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 Sing hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
For healing our bodies, for right mind,
hallelujah.
For keeping our mind in perfect
the peace.
Hallelujah.
You give us peace in my mind.
Hallelujah.
When the world is going crazy.
Hallelujah.
You give us peace. We say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
We thank you for the peace. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
We thank you for being patient with us. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
We got to say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
The highest praise we give you is.
Hallelujah.
The highest praise we give you is. Be without you in our life.
Hallelujah.
You saved us from the hand.
Hallelujah.
You saved us from the hand of the enemy.
Hallelujah.
We just want to say thank you, Lord.
Hallelujah.
And we got to say thank you, Lord.
Hallelujah.
Anybody pray for hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Anybody pray for hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
You never repay all you've done, Jesus.
Hallelujah.
But I can give you my praise and worship.
Hallelujah.
But I can wave my hands and give you glory.
Hallelujah.
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 Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Oh, my soul cries. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
My soul cries. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
I'm trying to stop, but I feel a hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
I want to quit, but I feel a hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Your love is like fire in my bones.
Give it to him this morning.
Hallelujah.
Come on.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Sometimes we don't have the words, but
hallelujah. Then sings my soul, my Savior God.
Able to come on, raise it up.
How great thou art.
All over the room, then sings my soul.
Then sings my soul, my Savior God to thee. How great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art! How great thou art!
Serve a great God, put those hands together in this room. If you know we serve the King of Kings, clap your hands and give him glory. Because he is great.
How great you are.
Tell the Lord, Lord, you're great.
How great you are.
Lord, you're great. Lord, you're great. Come on, give him your best praise this morning. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. 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 Thank you, Jesus. Yes, Lord. You know, I've learned, hopefully we're always growing and seeking God continually. And so I've been walking with the Lord for a little bit of time. But as of late, it's just so good to just sit. And quiet used to bother me, but now I just love it. Even in settings like this, sometimes it's just the peace of God that sweeps over you. Anybody feel that peace this morning? Hallelujah. And as we reflect on who God is and what he's able to do, we want to call out these names of people who have sent in their prayer request, because we know that we serve a God that can do absolutely anything. So Sister Emily Presley, we're praying for you this morning. Sister Diane Walker, Brother D'Angelo Cooper, Sister Barbara Richardson, Sister Lisa Wright, Brother Benjamin Wright, Mother Dolores Whitworth, Sister Valencia Benford, Sister Monica Scott, Sister Dorothy Bailey, Sister Margie Johnson, Minister Ruby Baker and family, Sister Mary Nether Strader, and those that have lost loved ones, Sister Latanya Spellman, Sister Kimberly Worthy and family, Sister Regina Gillespie and family. And those are the names that we have. If you did not get a chance to get your name in, it's okay, because God still knows what's going on with you. And he's concerned about everything that concerns you. He loves us so much. So let's go before the Lord in prayer. Kind Father, such an honor and a privilege to sit here with you this morning, to be in your house once again. Father, there's people who didn't make it today. They didn't see Sunday morning. But Father, you allowed us to make it, so we say thank you. Thank you for opening up our eyes this morning. Thank you that our hearts are still beating. Thank you, Lord God, that we can walk and we can talk and we can see and hear, smell. We don't want to take those things for granted, Lord. It's because of you. Thank you, Lord, for this service. Thank you, Lord God, for this atmosphere. Thank you for a monument of praise and what it means to us individually and this community. Thank you for our bishop. Thank you, Lord God, for the teaching. Thank you for his life and his example, and our co-founder as well. Thank you for our leadership, Lord. We lift them up to you, Lord God. We thank you for them. We thank you, Lord God, for this church and what you're doing in our hearts and what you're doing in our souls, how you're using us for your glory. And Father, some of our family members this morning, we've called their names before you. And Lord, we ask on their behalf that you meet the needs that they have presented, Lord God. We pray, Lord God, for those individuals that are suffering through loss and bereavement. Father, I know personally that you are the lifter of our heads. Father, I thank you, Lord God, that you will wrap your arms around them like only you can. I thank you, Lord God, for wiping away every tear. I thank you, Lord God, for causing them to have healthy grieving and not be stuck in a cycle of grief, Lord God. We thank you for deliverance from the spirit of heaviness, Lord God. And we pray, Lord God, that the oil of joy will overtake them right now, wherever they are. Lord God, those that are sick in their bodies, we know that you are our healer, God. We thank you, Lord. We know that there's nothing too hard for you. And we know that there's nothing that you cannot do. There's nothing that you cannot resolve. So, Father, we thank you, Lord God, for being the healer of our bodies. Not only our bodies, but some of our mental health is not right. Thank you for healing our minds. Thank you, Lord God, that you will do anything that we ask according to your will. So, Father, we know that it's not your will that we will be sick. You said that you wish above all things that we would prosper and be in health. even as our soul prospers. So, Father, we stand on your word and your promises. We thank you for divine healing, God. Cancer is no match for our God. Lupus is no match for our God. MS is no match for our God. So, Father, we thank you for healing diabetes. Lord, we believe in miracles, signs, and wonders. And we thank you that it can happen right now, even as we're praying, even as we're extending our faith, because we know that you are the healer. Even as we're having faith right now, we thank you that miracles are taking place. We thank you, Lord God, those that are struggling with their finances. We thank you for changing bank account measures, Lord God. We thank you for canceling debt. We thank you for moving behind the scenes. We thank you, Lord God, for release according to our faith it shall be. We thank you, Lord God, for those who are confused in their minds. We thank you, Lord God, that you said that you would keep us in perfect peace if we keep our mind on you. So, Father, we come against the power of the enemy that wants us to think on the wrong things. Your word says in Philippians, if there's going to be any praise, if there's going to be any strength, any virtue, we have to think on the things that are lovely, the things that are pure, the things that are honest, of a good report. Father, we turn our eyes on you because you are our help. We thank you that we can look to the hills from where our help comes from. Thank you for being our helper. Thank you for being our helper. Thank you for being our comfort. Thank you for being our covering. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for the blood that was shed. We thank you that you covered us, Lord God. We thank you that wherever we go, if we make our bed in hell, you're there. Father, we pray for unsaved loved ones this morning. We pray in the name of Jesus that you would send your Holy Spirit and arrest those that are lost this morning. It's not your will that any man should perish, but that all should come into repentance. So, Father, we call you. We call out the names of our family members, our friends, and our co-workers that need you. Father, save, hallelujah, save souls, Lord God. Even in this service, Lord, there may be someone who's watching or is in here who does not know you. Father, we thank you for the conviction of your Holy Spirit. Let that life be changed on today. But Father, we thank you for blessing Bishop as he preaches all the services today. I thank you for your Holy Spirit sweeping through every room, sweeping through every airway. Have your way, Holy Spirit. Father, we thank you for those that are just struggling in any kind of way. Maybe we don't know how to say it, but Lord, you know how to fix it. So Father, everything that I couldn't have the wisdom to say or call out, we thank you, Lord God, that you know the sentiments of our hearts. And Father, we thank you that you love us with an everlasting love. So Father, we give you glory, and as we anticipate the move of God, as we know it's already done, we celebrate you. As we know it's already done, we clap our hands. As we know it's already done, we give you glory. As we know it's already done, we open up our mouth because we know we have the victory. Thank you for the victory that comes through Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Thank you that you rose from the grave. And because you rose with all power, we can get up out of any situation. We cannot be overcome. Hallelujah. We overcome by the word of the testimony and the blood of the Lamb. Thank you for what you've done. And have your way in this service. Have your way in these people's lives. And we'll give you all the glory in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Amen. Come on, clap your hands, Zion. Clap your hands like you know it's already done. Clap your hands like you received a miracle. Oh, y'all don't seem excited. If you know God's heard your prayer, if you know he's got your back, he's not going to leave you where you are, you ought to give him a praise in this house. Hallelujah. Lord, we believe you. We believe you. We believe you, and we trust you. We believe you, and we trust you. We don't trust our eyes. We don't trust our ears. We don't trust the doctor's report. We trust you, God. We trust you, God. We know that you got it. We know that you got it. We know that you got it. And we walk in victory. 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 Victory is ours. Victory is ours. Victory is ours. I'm going to say it till you believe it. Victory is ours. Sometimes your victory is disguised in defeat. Sometimes your victory is disguised in defeat. See, we're in a war.
And sometimes because we lost a battle, we forget that this is not the whole matter, the conclusion of the matter. Sometimes you have a setback because God is doing something on the other side. We don't know his ways are above our ways. His thoughts are high above our thoughts. So you can't go through this life thinking your way. You got to have the mindset of God. God does things very differently. So you may have had a setback this week. You may be struggling in the area, but know that the story still ends in your victory. The story still ends in your victory. Read the back of the story. We win. In the back of the story, God already wrote it out. You win. You win. You win. So no matter what I'm facing, I can lift my hands because I know I got the victory. I haven't fought every battle, but I know that I'm going to win. I know that I'm the winner. He declared me the winner before the foundation of the world. Ephesians, come on. Before the foundation of the world, he declared you. Declared you the winner. So lift up your head, O ye gates. Be ye lift up, ye everlasting doors. And the King of glory shall come in. Who is this King of glory? He's the Lord God, strong and mighty. We got a strong God, the Lord God mighty in battle. He is the King of glory. Hallelujah. Woo! My God. We got announcements. Hallelujah. God bless you. Give your attention to the screen for our morning announcements. Hallelujah. Don't do it. Don't do it. Woo! Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Don't let them praise them by itself. We don't let nobody praise by themselves. It looks like she knows she's got the victory. Everybody clap, go! Thank you, Jesus. Everybody clap your hands. But they're on their feet and they're giving God glory. And guess what? I see you in your future. And you look much better than you do right now. Come on. I see my pastor who's been sick and he's in the building. You ought to give him praise this morning. Hey! Let's try this again. Hallelujah. Give your attention to the screen for our morning announcements, followed by the monument of praise, monument voices of praise. Hallelujah.
Welcome to Monument of Praise. We thank you for being here with us today. We ask that you please do not use audio or video devices during the service. Have a great day.
Join us tomorrow at 7 p.m. for our combined Bible study right here at Monument of Praise, 321 Oakview Road in High Point, North Carolina. We are excited to worship with you.
Praise, repent, ask, yield. Let's join a deacon ministry in prayer every Wednesday at 6 a.m. Call 605-562-8400 and use access code 544-0339.
Are you looking to lose some weight, build muscle, or improve your cardiorespiratory health? Well, you've asked, and guess what? The Fitness Drawing is back. Mike Bryce is a certified personal trainer who specializes in helping you turn your health around. Combined, previous winners have lost over 100 pounds, reversed the effects of type 2 diabetes, lowered their blood pressure, burned visceral fat, and the list goes on. Other winners were able to get rid of a cane they needed to walk, do squats without assistance, and walk miles without shortness of breath. One recent winner testified she lost 251 pounds, two clothing sizes, strengthened her back, which helped relieve the pain of scoliosis. Tickets are available starting today, and the winners will be drawn on April 28th. First place winner name is drawn, and the second place winner is picked by the person who has purchased the most tickets. You both will get 12 60-minute sessions that will change your life. That's a fitness package valued at over $700. Don't miss your opportunity to be in good health. Whatever your excuse is, it is time to stop believing it. Let's get it.
The Monument of Praise Church Yard Sale and Hot Dog Sale will be held on Saturday, April 27th from 7 a.m. to 12 p.m. at 321 Oakview Road in High Point, North Carolina. Table rentals are $20, a drink and two hot dogs is $5, and one hot dog is $2. Can't wait to see you there. Our assessments for New Jerusalem Cathedral Churches of Sound Doctrines are due on May the 1st. Please see a ministry leader or the church finance team for more details.
Happy birthday, happy anniversary, happy birthday from Monument of Praise. Happy birthday, happy anniversary, happy birthday from Monument of Praise.
Thanks for joining us at Monument of Praise. We pray that something is said or done to have you return. We love you and may God bless you.
Praise the Lord, everybody. Let's clap our hands for the goodness of the Lord. Amen. The Lord is good. Hallelujah. The Lord is good. The Lord is good. I'm happy to be here too. The Lord is so good. Amen. I'm happy to be here. I am so happy to be here. Hallelujah. I want to thank all of you for your prayers and your continued prayers. God is good. He is. He's good. Last week, I was unable to move, and I had to have preachers to preach for me, and Minister Tiki is amazing. She is amazing, your lady. I tell you, and Mike taught on Monday night amazingly. I thank you. Thank you so much, sweetheart. I appreciate that. I'm still watching myself. Amen. I don't know if you've, those of you, there's some people can relate, some people cannot, but if you ever had a back injury of any kind, you can be doing fine one day and thinking that you're okay, and that next day, I mean, one day I was 56 and the next day I was 106. And it happens. So I'm being careful right now. I'm mobile. I want to make sure that I don't do anything that's going to trigger anything. Praise the Lord. Amen. Now, I love each and every one of you. today, and I want everyone to hear my heart. When we do fellowship time, I'm not going to hug anybody today. I don't want anyone to be offended at the fact that I'm not, but I just don't want to trigger something right now. They're telling me that I have a torn ligament and that it has to repair itself. All right, so if I do certain things, it can trigger that, and it can be something as simple as a wrong movement and a slight hug. And so I've already started learning the steps that I can take without triggering. I probably would have been much better, but I was asked to preach on last week, and I had to go to Hamlet, North Carolina to preach. And so, you know, I got some sanctified Advil and things like that. And, you know, and you know, when you ain't feeling it and you get out there, you do your thing. And let me tell you something, when that Advil left, that back pain came tipping like, hey, you remember me? I didn't leave. We're married. We're not divorced. And it was crazy. So I had Bishop George Dawson to preach for me on Friday night. He is such an amazing preacher, and my brother. And so I'm thankful for him. I'm going to be teaching today and just going to balance myself. It may be that I may have one of the guys, if I need to go to my office and get a chair if I need to. If so, then I'm just going to do what I need to do. And I need everybody to be okay with that. Amen. So right now, this is what I would like for you to do. I'd like for you to step out of your seat and take, get about maybe 5, 6, or 7 people, put your arms around for monument time, and let's fellowship together right now just for a moment. But for those of you that are online, we want you to do the very same thing, and that is that let's take the time to fellowship with each other. This is a wonderful season that we are in, and God's favor definitely is upon us and upon our lives. And so let's make sure that we're loving on each other. Amen. Let's fellowship with one another right now. Hallelujah. 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 Glory to God. Glory to God. That's right. Let's fellowship together. Let's fellowship together. Thank you. want to thank you. Tomorrow night we will have Bible study and here, and then Thursday night we will be at our Greensboro facility serving there. I want to remind each and every individual, we have been afforded an opportunity, and I want all of us to take advantage of that opportunity. There was a movie that went nationwide, actually, for 2 days. The name of the movie was called The Ark in the Darkness, and it hit every movie theater for 2 days. It's a religious movie, and it deals with, it's a docu-movie. It's a documentary and a movie, and it deals with the depth of the Noah's Ark, but also it deals with eschatology and things that are to come. Well, what I did was, when it was played on a Friday, I think, and a Saturday last month, and then that was it. So I made a deal with the movie studio that I would, I told them if they would let me show the movie, and of course I'd have to submit to whatever they desired, that I wanted to show the movie, and they allowed me 10 showings in our facility in Greensboro to show the movie. And that, you know, it's still a movie. You still have to contact them to get tickets. It's online. And it should be. Is it up? You'll have it up here. See if you can get that flyer up here. And it's called The Ark in the Darkness. Now, it's on my personal social media. It's on New Jerusalem social media. It should be on Monument social media as well. And the next showings, because they've given us 10 showings. We had 3 showings yesterday. And we will have 2 showings on this coming Friday. That is 4:00 and 7:30. And then we will have 3 showings on this coming Saturday. That will be 12 noon, 3:30, and 7:30. We will have 1 showing next Sunday at 5:00. And then the last showing will be Monday at 6:00. And that will take care of, so we still have 7 more showings. Everyone that has come has immensely enjoyed the empowerment and the knowledge that is connected to the movie. At some point, I'll probably be answering some questions. And yes, it's just like it is a theater in our facility. And so we have popcorn and hot dogs candy and sodas and different things like that we have there. It is an enjoyable experience, I promise you it is. We've spent a lot of money not only on LED screens and things like that in Greensboro, but also the sound system that will give you that level of impact. So, you know, those woofers and things like that will have your liver quivering. You know, and so it's one of those kind of things. When you're building things, people don't realize what you're doing. And my perspective is like biblical business. I think that's the best way to say it. God has given me insight when it comes to things that are taking place in the future and what is going to be needed. So I will be building and doing things according to that. And with that being said, I want everybody not only to go, but I want it to be on everybody's social media. So this is what we're asking. We're asking for what we call a social media flood. One of my young people told me that today. That's what is called, a social media flood. Where on 12:00 every day this week, we will put the advertisement of the movie on our social media and put it out there and just send it out for everybody to be able to see it. Once you do that QR code, and the money goes straight to the movie studio, and then they'll let us know that you bought a ticket. So we're not in control of the tickets, the movie studio is. And this is our first time doing this. I'll tell you all, and I pray that you learn from me. I'm never afraid to learn anything. I'm just never afraid. You know, my attitude is simply this. If you've never done something before, then you will have never done it before if you don't try it the first time. You know, so you have to figure out, you have to be able to make a leap of faith and then and be honest with people and tell them, I don't know what I'm doing, but I'm trying it. You know, you ever cook something and never cooked it before? Like, I do not know what I'm doing, but I'm just going to give it a try. If it work out, great. If not, I got Domino's on speed dial, you know, and that's how you, so we're doing this, and it is tremendous. This is a milestone for us because this is the first time that we're collaborating with a production company, movie studio, in order to do something like this. The ironic part, and this is the first time I'm saying this anywhere, the ironic part is that now they have stated that because of the way that we've handled this and our professionalism, now we're professionals and we don't know what we're doing, okay? We don't know what we're doing. But one of the things that I've told people, and that is that regardless of what business you are in, when it comes to business, you don't necessarily have to know the business if you know the principles of business. And if you operate within those principles, you will always be okay. But we operate in the principles of business, and now we haven't even finished this movie, and they've already told us that they would like to collaborate with us again on another movie. And so we are trailblazing in this situation, and I want everyone, if you would, I want everyone to at least go to the movie at least once. Some people say they're going to go twice, but go to the movie at least once. It's very knowledgeable, very impactful. It will shift your mindset, of course, because I teach eschatology. You know, I sat there in the movie and I wanted to know, all right, where's the accuracy? Are they off or are they on? Am I off or am I on? And when I looked at the movie, that we are gelling right in the same place. It is just right there. These are doctors of theology from different colleges and universities in the country that came together to do this movie. And it made me realize if that movie didn't do anything else, and it did a lot of things for me, but that movie taught me something. And that is that when I preach to you on a university collegiate level of information. Amen? Amen. So I want everyone to at least go on Friday night, 7:30. We have said that it's youth night. It doesn't mean that you can't come. It's just what we're trying to do is garner a lot of youth to be able to go there to be empowered, because we're not doing the proper things that we should be doing for our youth, and we need to change our trajectory concerning that. When David was anointed king, he was a teenager. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego go into the fiery furnace. They were teenagers. When Paul was writing to Timothy, he was a teenager. And sometimes we keep thinking that teenagers are not old enough. And if we look at the age that they were when they were in the Bible, we'll find out that we were not following sometimes grown men. We were following teenagers that had major faith. Amen? Amen. So tell your neighbor, I want to see you at the movies. 2 Corinthians, the 12th chapter, starting at verse 7. 2 Corinthians, the 12th chapter, starting at verse 7. And Second Corinthians 12, starting at verse 7. Starting at verse 7. And Queen Esther's Court. I think that initiative, and this is our women's ministry, Queen Esther's Court, they will do a launch on this coming Saturday. And I want everybody to make sure that you are connected to Queen Esther's Court. Choir, you did a wonderful job. Harriet. Harriet did a phenomenal job in doing her solo today. She wouldn't look up for a while. She's like, mm-mm, I'm not doing it. But I want to tell you that I love the fact that you are willing to step out of comfort zone. You know, that's where great faith moves. So you did a phenomenal job, sweetheart, a phenomenal job. I love you so much. Amen. She did such a phenomenal job. Amen. Glory to God. I tell you, when you do things like that, you can always tell people nervous. They're like, Lord, help me. You know, they got their eyes go straight to the Lord. Please. Your humble servant. All right. So let's go to 2 Corinthians 12, starting at verse 7, and says, unless I should be exalted above measure through the abundance of revelation. This is Paul talking now. He says, there was given to me a thorn in the flesh, the messenger of Satan, to buffet me, lest I should be exalted above measure. For this thing I besought the Lord thrice, that it might depart from me. And he said unto me, my grace is sufficient for thee, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. Most gladly, therefore, will I rather glory in my infirmities, that the power of Christ may rest upon me. Therefore, I take pleasure in infirmities and reproaches and necessities and persecution and distresses for Christ's sake. For when I am weak, then am I strong. I am become a fool in glorying. Ye have compelled me. For I ought to have been commended of you. For in nothing am I behind the very chiefest apostles, though I be nothing. Truly the signs of an apostle were wrought among you in all patience, in signs and wonders and mighty deeds. For what is it wherein ye were inferior to other churches, except it be that I myself have not burdensome to you, was not burdensome to you. Forgive me this wrong. Now, I want you all to hear what he's saying. Paul, and usually when we read this scripture, there's a certain point that we read and then we stop. Later on, what you're seeing is Paul is acknowledging that even in leading you, there was something in my character that was flawed and I was wrong. And now he's making an apology. Just because you have a title doesn't mean that you won't make a mistake. And you've got to be willing to acknowledge when you are in error. It doesn't make you no less of a child of God to say, I did that wrong. And so watch what Paul says in verse 14. After he said, forgive me this wrong, he says, behold, the third time I am ready to come to you, and I will not be burdensome to you. In other words, this time when I come, I'm not coming with the same baggage. For I seek not yours, but you. For the children ought not to lay up for the parents, but the parents for the children. In other words, he says, the children should not have to do the parents' job. The parent should be doing the parents' job. And so he said, but in this situation, I've learned from my children a character that now I'm going to walk in the effectiveness and the maturity of that character. It's a very unique take on scripture, because sometimes in preaching, a lot of times ministers preach something that they want people to be excited about, but we stop short of something that can teach us how to live better. So if you don't mind, tell somebody these words, the evolution of truth, evolution of growth. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord, the evolution of growth. I want to explain a couple of things here concerning, and I think the first thing that I need to deal with is the word evolution. Because the moment that we hear evolution, we immediately think of Darwin's theory, and from ape to human, we know that that is not true. We know that the creation of man had to do with God's creation himself, and not some metamorphosis from a tadpole to a frog. But the evolution of growth And I chose that because of the true definition of evolution. So if you would, write it down so that if there is any confusion later, at least you have it to reference. The word evolution means this. It means the gradual development of something, especially from a simple state to a more complex form. The gradual development of something, especially from a simple state to a more complex form. That is the true definition of evolution. Developing something from a simple state to a more complex form, which ultimately means it is growing, it is maturing, it is advancing, it is changing. There's another scripture that would really reflect this kind of thing, and that is when the Word of God says in Romans 12, not to be conformed to this world, but to be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. But here is where we now grow, because if I'm going to be transformed, then now I'm moving into a more of a growing adult kind of thinking in my spiritual realm and in my spiritual life. When I look at the Word of God and I see how it's written from Genesis to Revelation, I observe the mastery of the Holy Ghost, of how the Holy Spirit himself has written the Word. And I said, the Holy Spirit is the one that wrote the Word, and I'll prove it in a couple of scriptures. Look at 2 Peter, if you would, the first chapter, the 20th and the 21st verse. It says this, it says, knowing this first, that no prophecy of the scripture is of any private interpretation. There is no prophecy of the scripture. The Word of God is not by any private interpretation, which means it has man's influence in it in any kind of way. For the prophecy came not in old time by the will of man, but by holy men of God. Watch this. But holy men of God spake as they were moved by the Holy Ghost. So now we have men of God, holy men of God, that under the direction of the Holy Spirit wrote down, became the scribes or the secretaries for the Holy Ghost to write the details of Scripture down. See, as long as the Holy Ghost was driving the secretary, we know that the Word of God is not a journal. It is the Holy Word of God. If it is only men writing, then now it's a journal or just a book. But when the Holy Ghost is doing the driving, then now the words that are adopted here is holy. From Genesis to Revelations covers about 4,000 years of mankind. And I won't get into it, because actually in the movie it depicts a lot of this. Man, science wants to say that the earth is 2 million years and 5 million years and 6 million years and 30 million years and whatever million years ago. But they're going by a method that is not accurate. And so the Word of God gives us accuracy of the age of the earth. We are not any more than 6,000 years old. And the transitions that have happened within that time is key. And so the Word of God deals with 4,000 years of information. but it also prophetically gives a word of the other years that are coming. So it covers then the whole span of creation and the time that we are in and the times that are coming. But it has a point of when it stops, where we deal with the book of Revelations, where John is on the Isle of Patmos and he's writing. Please understand here is that this is why from Genesis to Revelation, it all moves seamlessly. Even though they're 4,000 years, it seems like the same person has written it because the same person has. It is the Holy Spirit that has done all of the revelation, and he has moved on holy men of God for them to write. Look at 2 Timothy, the 3rd chapter and the 16th verse. It says, all scripture is given by inspiration of God. All scripture is given by what? Inspiration of God, and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness. Now, one of the things that I am sharing here, and that is two different dimensions that happen in the Word of God of our learning of what it tells. There are two different dimensions and three stages in those dimensions. The first dimension, the word reveals three stages of man. The three stages of man is the creation of man, it is the fall of man, and it is the redemption of man. That is the things that we obviously see within the Word of God. Man was created. Man failed God, and there was a fall. And then what the Lord did in order to redeem us, which is the last Adam, who is Jesus, who came and redeemed us from the hand of the enemy. That is the creation of man. That is the fall of man, and that is the redemption of man. But then the second dimension that has three pieces of development here deals with this part. The Word of God also deals with the immortality of man. It deals with the reward of man, and it deals with the eternal position of man. Let's talk about that for a second. The immortality of man. Remember, he speaks to us in 1 Corinthians, the 15th chapter, and he tells us, I'm going to change you from mortal to immortality, from corruptible to incorruptible. The immortality of man really deals with what we call a glorified body. Everybody say with me, a glorified body. A glorified body is a body that cannot be contaminated. A glorified body is a body that cannot die. A glorified body is a body that can do things like transcend in ways that a regular body doesn't do. So I'll give you an example of that. When Jesus died and he rose with all power in his hand, he rose then in a glorified body. The Bible says that he did not walk it through a door. He actually walked through the walls in order to talk to his disciples because he was in a glorified body. When we are changed from mortal to immortality, we are changed into glorified bodies. Once you get your glorified body, according to the Word of God, you can never see death again. Again, once you get your glorified body, you can never see death again. Praise the Lord, everybody. All right, so that is the immortality of man. The next thing is the reward of man. Everybody say with me, the reward of man. The reward of man deals with 1 Corinthians, the 3rd chapter. And this is where the Lord says that I'm going to try every man's work of what sort it is, whether it is gold, silver, wood, hay, stubble, to make sure that in turn that when I reward you for what the things that you did with a right heart. He says you yourself will be saved, but the work itself has got to be tried. Then that is the second part, the reward of man. The last part is the eternal position of man. Please write it down. The eternal position of man. Now, this is something that preachers, to be honest with you, hardly ever touch. And the reason being is because it is dealing with more of an eschatological explanation. And usually ministers are not as comfortable with eschatology. And so this is why I'm telling you to write it, so that you can recycle it and have it, so that you'll know what the future looks like. Now, the eternal position of man is past then the end of days. It is past then the tribulation period. It is past the battle of Armageddon. It is past then the Jesus throwing the Antichrist or the false prophet into the lake of fire. It is past this point where he takes Satan and he's putting him in a bottomless pit, and then after that he is loose for a while, and then after he's loose for a while, the Lord then tells him, now you're going to go into the fire and burn eternally. So this is in the area that we're in. So we're talking about the eternal position of man, watch this, which will be the eternal dispensation of the kingdom of God. See, the end of days, what we deal with when we talk about the end of days, we're talking about the end of human government and the beginning of the kingdom of God government. This is where the book of Revelations talks about it, I believe in Revelations 15, where he says, and he reigns forever and ever, because we're dealing with the time we're in, that now we're dealing with the kingdom of God being our government. This is where Christ will be physically on the earth. Everybody say with me, physically. He will be physically on the earth with us in a glorified state where we can go up and see him, because his headquarters will actually be here on the earth. Let's say it again, that when we're dealing with the kingdom of God government, we're dealing with the fact that what happens is that he will then set up his kingdom on the earth. You remember the book of Revelations, John said, and I saw a city called New Jerusalem, and it's coming, and then it's set down where? Here on the earth. So where will his kingdom, where his kingdom will be, where he set his headquarters? His headquarters will be here on the earth. Well, then you said that we'll be able to go up and see him and talk to him if we so desire. Yes, we will be scattered all over the earth, but we'll be able to go and see him in a glorified body. How do you know that, Pastor Williams? I know that because of Isaiah, the second chapter, the second and the third verse. Let's take a look at it. Let's see what it says. The scripture says, and it shall come to pass in the last days that the mountain of the Lord's house shall be established in the top of the mountains and shall be exalted above the hills, and all nations shall flow unto it. But look at the next verse. The next verse says, and many people shall go up and say, come ye and let us go up to the mountain of the Lord, to the house of the God of Jacob, and he will teach us of his ways, and we will walk in his paths. For out of Zion shall go forth the law and the word of the Lord from Jerusalem. Now, it's not a part of this message right here, but if you read the next verse, it will address the fact that there will be no more war, because now men will take their weapons, drive them against stones, and make then farming tools out of them, because there will be no more war. When we're talking about the eternal position of man, look at Revelations, the fifth chapter and the tenth verse. Let's take a look. The Bible says, and this is the Lord, what the Lord is going to do concerning us, and has made us unto our God kings and priests, and we shall reign on the earth. Everybody say, we shall reign on the earth. Now, when it says we shall reign on the earth, and the Bible says, notice, he says we will be kings and priests. Notice he does not say kings, queens, and priests. Only kings and priests. So even though there are women, there will still be, you still have to understand the title of kings and priests, because it is ultimate authority when it comes to the kingdom of God. Now, some people are like, well, how will we be kings and priests, and what will be kings over? We will be kings over provinces, and we'll be kings over geographical areas, and kings over cities. What is your explanation for that, Pastor Williams? It's very simple. In the book of Luke, the 19th chapter, the Bible says that he says the kingdom of God is likened, and this is how it's going to be. He says, a nobleman gave £1 to 10 of his servants. So he gave out £10 to 10 different men. When he came back, the one servant said, the 1 pound that you gave me, I have gained 10 pounds. And what did the Lord say? He says, in return, I'm giving you authority over 10 cities in my kingdom. Well, it merges directly with Revelation, the 5th chapter and the 10th verse, that we will be kings and priests, because he will make us kings and priests. So here is where we are. When we're looking at this, we're looking at what we call the development or the evolution of growth. We're seeing how God is maturing us and growing us. Even right now, while I'm preaching, you're hearing some of this for the first time, and it's kind of like, wow, I haven't heard that before. I haven't understood it before. Because the way that we have looked at it in the past, in ignorance, we said, all right, we're just going to go up to heaven and shout in heaven all day. Let me tell you something. You ain't read the word of God long enough. Because if you keep reading, you're going to find that we're going to make a U-turn and come right back here. Because this is why John said, and behold, I saw a new heaven and a new earth. Because the first heaven and the first earth was passed away. And when you look in the book of Revelations, we're not living in heaven all of that time. We come back to the earth to live in our glorified body. Why? Because earth was made for man and heaven was made for God. Am I making good sense? All of this is about the process of development. What really is development? Development means to grow or cease, watch this, to grow or to cause to grow and become more mature, advanced, or elaborate, to start to, watch this, to exist and also to experience. That is what it is meant by development. So here it is. When I looked in the word of God, the word develop is not in the word of God. The word development is not in the word of God. But when I look at the definition of develop and the definition of development, I find the definition, the words that represent development within the word of God. One of those words is grow. Everybody say with me, grow. So anytime you see the word grow in the word of God, you can put develop or development in that space, and it's going to mean the same thing, and it may even give you a better understanding of that word. So now let's go for an example. I'm going to do two examples. The first example I'm going to do is Genesis, the 2nd chapter and the 9th verse. The Bible says, and out of the ground made the Lord God to grow. Let's change it and say it again. And out of the ground made the Lord God to develop every tree that is pleasant to the sight and good for food, the tree of life also in the midst of the garden, and the tree of knowledge of good and evil. So when you see the word grow, you also understand that the word is also develop. So there is no way that God is growing you and not developing you. While he is growing you, you are being developed. Again, while you are growing, you are being developed. Let's then go for another scripture, because I can do this all day. When you get home, you can find all the words that have grow in there. Put the word develop, it'll mean the same thing. Go to Ecclesiastes, the 11th chapter and the 5th verse. When you go there, I'm going to read this here, and let's make good sense out of it. The Bible says, and remember, I'm going to use the word grow because that's what it says, but then we can interchange it with the word develop. As thou knowest not what is the way of the spirit, nor how the bones do grow in the womb of her that is with child. Let's say it again. And thou knowest not what is the way of the spirit, nor how the bones do develop in the womb of her that is with child. Even so, thou knowest not the works of God who maketh all. So when you look at the word grow, you look at the word develop, it means the same thing. So now we're seeing how when people say, I am growing, there is impossible for you to be growing and not developing, which means that God is strengthening some areas. He is empowering some areas. The scripture says, you don't even know how the bones are developed. How is it that it starts off as a liquid, but it ends up as a solid? He says, you don't know how bones are developed. He says, but I'm the one that develops the
bones inside of the womb of the woman. He says, I can take the liquid and turn it to a solid, and you live the rest of your life with this solid skeletal position, but it started off as a liquid. The greatness of God and the majesty of God to be able to develop us in a way that right now in our life, in my life, in your life, God is developing something on the inside of you. And this is why it takes some time for development. See, predicated on what God is going to do with you and what he's using you for is going to determine how long it's going to take for you to develop. Let me give you an example. For a child, it takes 9 months to be in a mother's womb in order for that child to be developed. However, for an elephant, it takes 2 years. The question is why? When the child comes out, and the child can't even crawl. All they can do is move and kick. When the elephant comes out, he comes out running. Y'all don't like the way that I'm talking. Please understand, if God has you in a holding pattern for a while, it's because when he drops your vision, it's going to come out running. The process of growth and development comes from one thing in your life that impacts the next thing in your life to teach you and develop the character that it will take to sustain your conviction and your walk with God. Please understand, see, while God is developing your vision, he's also developing your character to be able to handle the vision that he puts out there. God is not going to give you a multi-million dollar vision and leave you with a cheap character. Look at somebody and tell them, you got to be able to handle what God's going to give you. Don't go after a million-dollar house if you don't want them payments. See, getting it is one thing. Sustaining it is something else. Now, I want to get the car, but I don't want to see the car driving down the street behind something. Development is about what's working. Everybody say, inside me. That's what development is. Development is about working inside of me. There's an old song that the church used to sing, and I'm talking about 70, 80 years ago. And there was a song that said, there's something on the inside that's working on my outside. Oh, what a change in my life. There is now, when you're being developed, there's an internal growth or maturity that is happening. Let's look at Romans, the 5th chapter, the 3rd through the 6th verse, and I'm going to show you how this internal growth actually works. The Bible says, and not only so, but we glory in tribulation also. Everybody say, we glory in tribulation. Watch this. Knowing that tribulation worketh patience, and patience experience, and experience hope, and hope maketh not ashamed, because the love of God is shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Ghost, which is given unto us. For when we were yet without strength, in due time Christ died for the ungodly. Now I need you to look at the process of development that God sends us through. Look at that third verse. The third verse says, you can't start developing in tribulation without glory. Tell somebody, I need glory. Now notice what it says is up here. All right, so let's look at this. And not only so, but we glory, watch this, in tribulation. Everybody say with me, in tribulation. Now watch this. You're not glorying because of tribulation. You're glorying in. I'm preaching. You're glorying in tribulation. The Lord is telling you, he says, no, don't be talking about, oh, I'm happy, you know, that I'm going through. Ain't nobody happy they're going through. Ain't nobody happy about that. And people looking at you, where your joy? Don't nobody like you. I'm not happy, watch this, about that tribulation.
But watch what it says, because I need you to understand the value of what glory is. First of all, let's find out what glory is. I'm going to give you two words to make it real simple. Glory is two words, joy and rejoice. Joy and rejoice. Now he said joy and rejoice. Everybody say in tribulation. Say it again, in tribulation. Not because of tribulation. Everybody say with me, in tribulation. So he said, I want you to have joy and rejoice in tribulation. And what is tribulation? Tribulation is pressing together, a pressing together. It means distress. It means affliction. It means persecution. It means trouble. He says, so I want you to have joy and rejoice in the trouble. I want you to have joy and rejoice in the persecution. I want you to have joy and rejoice in the affliction, in the distress, in the pressing together. Not because of it, but in it. Now let's explain how that works. Now, in order for me to have joy in it, I had to have joy before it. I'm going to say it again. I had to have joy before if I'm going to have joy in it. The scripture said, count it all what? Joy. He said, you got to count up your joy. He said, because when you get joy, the joy of the Lord is your what? To strength to do what? To have joy what? In tribulation. Ooh, I know I'm preaching to somebody. All right, now let's look at it. So a major reason for delayed development is while experiencing tribulation, we forget to have joy and rejoice, or either we do it late after complaining. Now my back is hurt, but ain't nothing wrong with my mouth. Glory to God's name. I need you to look at this. He said, if you end up rejoicing in tribulation and you all way in it, he said, you late. You can't complain for 9 months and then on the 10th month talk about I got joy. No. You done flunked. Now you got to start over, because, watch this, because every stage, you go through things in semesters. Am I making sense? You go through things in semesters. So when you go through things in semesters, preach, Kev, when you go through things in semesters, I'm going to show you biblically how you come in as a freshman. Then a sophomore, then a junior, then a senior. I'm going to show you all why some of you all have been in this for 30 years and still a freshman. Woo! Lord have mercy. Where my security at? Because I can't run. We just got to fight. I mean, like them old men walking. So watch this. I want you to notice something. Notice the glory is there before the tribulation. And then, watch this, it remains. While tribulation, watch this, is working patience. See, the glory has to last freshman year, sophomore year, junior year, senior year. It has to continue to last. You can't get glory in tribulation, and then when it comes time to patience, you ain't got no joy. Everybody say tribulation, tribulation is freshman year. Say it again, tribulation is freshman year. So the only way you can pass your freshman year is that you have glory before class starts. And while you're going through it, oh, y'all don't like the way that I'm talking. All right. So let me explain another way. Because some of y'all like, you know, well, I got the victory. I'm shouting. No, you're shouting at the wrong time. Let me tell you why. All right. So we're talking about it from a collegiate level. Let's look at it from this point of view. How many of you would know, I don't know whether you've been to college or not, it doesn't matter to know this answer. How many of you know in order to get in college, you must qualify? You have to qualify. You just can't walk up in there and say, I want to enroll. No. Do you qualify? We got to see your test. We got to see certain things to see if you qualify. Everybody say, I got to qualify. All right. Now, when you qualify, some people go to shouting, but listen, let me tell you something. You ain't got no degree. You just qualified. You qualified, watch this, for the classes. You qualified to take the classes. You ain't won nothing. Why do we glory in tribulation? We glory because we count ourselves worthy. That God said, you have developed enough that I can send you through something and you're going to know how to have joy through it. Watch this. I'm not having joy about the tribulation. I'm having joy because I matured enough that I'm qualified, that God says now you can be tested. Am I making good sense? So don't get excited because you got accepted to college. Pass your classes. And stop being a career student. Y'all ain't like that part. Let's look at it. So watch this. Glory where? In tribulation. In this pressure, in this persecution, in this trouble, he said, I want you to have joy and I want you to rejoice. Watch this, not about the problem, but about the fact that he counted you worthy, and that means that he's given you the wherewithal to be able to go through it. Now watch this. Tribulation then worketh what? Patience, which is steadfastness and endurance. So God says, you're going to have to rejoice while you're being steadfast. And while you're enduring, watch this. Now notice, the tribulation hasn't gone anywhere, but you've added now patience while you're going through the tribulation. When you get to patience, you are at your sophomore year. Am I making sense? All right, then watch this. Patience is endurance, is steadfastness. Patience is going, watch this, your patience is going to work. What's next? Your experience. Experience now is your what? Junior year. Now you've done your freshman year, you've done your sophomore year, but now experience is your junior year. What is experience? Now I've got to have joy in all of this. And so in my junior year of experience, watch this, your junior year experience is what? Proving. It tries your character. A specimen tried, watch this, a specimen of tried worth. It's proof of who you are. Because now dealing with your character, watch this. Because you can't go through tribulation and you can't go through patience without it building your character, your experience. Am I making sense? All right. So that's my junior year. But now what is my senior year? Hope. The word hope means to anticipate. It means expectation, watch this, of evil, fear, or expectation of good. Now, I know that threw some of y'all off for a second, but it's going to make good sense. Have you ever seen people that they always are expecting, but they're always expecting something to go wrong? They're always expecting something bad to happen. I don't like being around them folk. They get in the car riding with you, and all of a sudden, I don't know, you want to be careful. You could have a car accident. I don't need you to walk. Don't be bringing that fear in my front seat. I ain't had no thoughts about no car accident or nothing until you come up in here with your wayward mouth. Hallelujah. My bag, ain't nothing wrong with my mouth. I just, they drive, just walk, get an Uber. and mess around. The Uber driver made it put you out too. You just walk. Because, and I'm going to show you why some people hope in the bad and some people hope in the good. Notice your hope of evil or good is based on, watch this, your experience, your patience, and your tribulation. Your good experience versus your bad experience has nothing to do with you, has nothing to do with another person, has nothing to do with your circumstances, has nothing to do with any of that. Your good view versus your negative view has everything to do with, did you go through it with glory or without? If I go through tribulation and patience and experience and a hope with joy and with rejoicing, I always will have an outlook and an expectation that something good is going to happen. But if I go through tribulation and patience and experience and a hope with no glory, that I'm always expecting something negative is going to happen. Let me tell you something. My Bible tells me to people that rejoice all the time and the people that have joy in things, that all things work together for the good of them that love the Lord, for them who are the called according to his purpose. Am I making sense to anybody here? You got to get that negative and doubting and I just ain't happy. And it's like, get that out of there. That is messing with your algorithm to get you to victory. Am I preaching to somebody up in here? You got to get your joy back. So that when your tribulation happens, you're going through tribulation with joy and patience with joy and experience with joy and hope with joy. And the Bible says if you go through all of that with joy, then the hope maketh not ashamed. That's why Paul said, I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ, because it is the power of God unto salvation to everybody that believes. I gotta go through it with the glory. Woo! When we go through something without the glory, it stops our proper development. But when we go through something with the glory, we develop good, quick, and strong. Your faith ain't gonna be damaged. Your life ain't gonna be damaged. You ain't gonna go through all of that, because you're gonna learn how to have glory before tribulation comes so that you can glory in it. If you can win your freshman year going through it with glory, you can do your sophomore, your junior, and your senior year. Now I'm gonna say something to you. This is for the people that are like this. Watch this. This is for the people that are glorying through tribulation, and these are the people that are not glorying through tribulation. Hear what I'm saying. Everybody will mature. You cannot stop maturing. Everybody will develop. You cannot stop developing. Maturing is going to happen regardless. But watch this. Some people mature in wisdom, and some people mature in ignorance. See, we keep looking at maturing as a positive thing, but maturing ain't always positive if you're maturing in bitterness and not happiness. How are you saved, love God, but you are a professional unforgiver? You should be maturing in your forgiveness, not your unforgiveness. Am I making sense to anybody up in here? Now ask your neighbor. We're going to see what they say. Ask your neighbor, where you mature at? They don't even want to answer you. See, you can't grow in God being an excellent, and you got a PhD in unforgiveness. How are
are you saved this long and you still get mad that quick? How you saved this long and you still got an attitude that quick? You can't go through all of that with glory and still be that sarcastic. It's real quiet in here, Will. I would tell you to play, but I'm not there yet. They just got to deal with this. I can't even tell you to soothe them. Glory to God. I know when we get out of here, I don't want the police driving behind me because you done called them talking about I was assaulted in church. He kept punching me, sir, right in my gut. In order to develop properly in life, you have to have the glory or you will miss your benchmarks of growth and development. Now, let me go back to the text, and this is where we're going to close out. But I'm closing out by making sense of a text that we heard so much, but never really looked at really what he was saying. And I'll put it in what I just taught you. Look at 2 Corinthians, the 12th chapter, the 7th verse. And lest I should be exalted above measure through the abundance of revelation, there was given to me a thorn in the flesh, the messenger of Satan, to buffet me, lest I should be exalted above measure. What did he experience in verse 7? Tribulation. Now remember, tribulation works what? Patience, and patience works what? Experience. All right, let's look at verse 8. For this thing I besought the Lord thrice. What is that? Patience. That it might depart from me. What is that? Experience. Look at the 9th verse. And he said unto me, my grace is sufficient for thee, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. What is that? Hope. Am I making sense? He's showing you how to go through it properly. And he's showing Paul, you're anointed, you're an apostle, but you're in error in your character. Watch what Paul responds. Most gladly, therefore, will I rather what? Glory in my infirmities. In my infirmities. In tribulation. In my infirmities, that the power of Christ may rest upon me. The power of Christ is not coming unto you glory in it. I feel like I'm by myself because you didn't bring no glory with you. That's why you by yourself. I feel like God abandoned me. The reason you feel like God abandoned you is because you kept ignoring the fact that he told you bring your glory with you. If you bring your glory with you, I'll come for you and your glory, but I ain't coming for you. That's why you bitter. That's why you're unforgiving. That's why you're mad. That's why you're angry, because you didn't bring glory with you. Watch what happens. Therefore, I take pleasure. Look at verse 10. Therefore, I take pleasure in infirmities, in reproaches, in necessities, in persecutions, in distresses for Christ's sake. For when I am weak, then I am strong. Watch this. Everything is in. Is this preaching? Now I'm preaching better than y'all saying amen. Now this filet mignon. With a rosemary butter on top of it and the right seasoning. Been tenderized and aged. Glory to God's name. Don't start me, I can cook. Now watch what he says in verse 11. He says, I am become a fool in glorying. Now it makes sense. He said, Now I understand that the system to defeat the enemy and to develop myself is bring glory with me in it. Now he says, I am become a fool in glorying. Ye have compelled me, for I ought to have been commended of you. For in nothing am I behind, watch this, the very chief apostle, though I be nothing. Watch what he's saying. He says, I have watched your character. I've watched you glorying in what you're going through, but I wasn't. And now I see my error. Watch what happens. Watch what he says. Truly the signs of an apostle were wrought among you in all patience and signs and wonders and mighty deeds. He says the patience of an apostle was resting on you, and I'm the one that's an apostle, and it wasn't even resting on me. Because I wasn't going through what I needed to properly, bringing glory in it with me. Am I making sense? Watch what it says here. Look at verse 13. For what is it wherein ye were inferior to other churches, except it be that I myself was not burdensome to you? Forgive me this wrong. He said, I was comparing you to other people that I felt that were more mature than you were. He says, and I'm realizing you were more mature than they were, and I was a burden to you by calling you something that you weren't, because you were going through it right. And I thought that the other churches that had attitude and that was handling people wrong, they were going through it correctly. He said, but I realize now that I made an error. Look at the 14th verse. Behold, watch his wording. Behold, the third time I am ready to come to you, and I will not be burdensome to you. He said, the third time I'm going to come to you. Now, do you remember earlier he besought the Lord three times, and the Lord said, my grace is sufficient. Now, we see why the Lord didn't answer him. He said, because if I don't answer you, it forces you to learn. If I keep delivering you, it ain't fixing you. It's going to make you more arrogant. But if I show you that the same grace that you need is the same grace that you're going to have to give.
See, here's the deal. We keep wanting grace from people that we won't give grace to. Now, you think about that for a second. I've seen so many people with an attitude. No, I don't want them to have no music yet. I want them to be mad. See, here's the deal. We keep wanting a whole bunch of grace. Forgive me for this. 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 You got 100 things you've been forgiven for, but the moment that somebody makes one wrong move, you're ready to throw them away. You're mad. You're going through a whole bunch of changes. I can't believe. And you're going through all of that. That shows your level of immaturity. That shows that you ain't been through nothing with glory. That shows that you haven't grown up. Let me say this to you. When I look at that scripture, y'all hear what I'm saying? Paul, as an apostle and a leader, admitted he made a mistake. That the people of God were living better in that area than he was, because he had made an error. Here's the interesting thing. The people didn't get mad and leave and say, God is calling me to another church. Just because you find out that your pastor is human doesn't mean that God is calling you to another church. It only means that when you're dealing with humanity, everybody's got to grow. Now, let me stop your mind for a second, because I ain't done nothing. So let me help you out just for a minute. So the enemy don't get in your head. I'm preaching this from a clear spirit, a clear mind. I ain't done nothing but hurt my back. Because the enemy get in your head, I wonder what has happened with the pastor. Ain't nothing happened with the pastor. Oh, jacked up discernment. Glory to God's name. Ain't nothing happened with that pastor. Then people go to God getting spooky. You know, I felt something in my spirit. You had no business eating Funyuns and Pepsi. That's what's in your spirit. Funyuns. And Doritos. Glory to God's name. But here's the deal. We have got to learn that even when the best people can still make an error. And stop abandoning people because they've shown a human side when you don't want to be abandoned when you've shown a human side. Don't be looking at me talking about your back shouldn't be hurting if you have enough faith. It ought to be healed right now. How ridiculous do you sound? If I fall down a flight of steps, what am I going to tell my leg? Don't bleed. In Jesus' name. If that was the case, then he wouldn't have bled on the cross, would he? We keep forgetting the fact of the human element of this. And that's why the Lord said, some things I'm not going to heal you from or deliver you from, but my grace is sufficient for you. Keep going through it with integrity, with glory, with joy, and rejoice. You made a mistake, but you ain't made no more mistake than nobody else has made.
I expected more from the church. I expected more from the people of God.
The people of God and the church is not Christ. We're his bride. He said he's still working on all of us. He's the one that's perfect, not us. We still burning dinners. Am I making good sense here? Let me close this out because this is what he says here in the 14th verse. He says here in that B clause, he says, for I seek not yours, but you. He says, for the children ought not to lay up for the parents, but the parents for the children. He said, I should have been a better example in this area. But you can't, now watch this. But you can't say he wasn't a good leader. Why? Because they had learned something that he wasn't walking in through his teaching. You have to look at sometimes when you are the head of your family or the head of your business or you're the head of a church or an auxiliary or something like that, sometimes you can teach people things that they get it and you don't get it. Moses didn't make it to the promised land because he let the people that he was leading get on his nerves. How did I miss it dealing with you? How did I get so mad at you? I missed my promise. Some years ago, and you'll know what I'm talking about, and I don't mind calling names because it's just the accuracy of what it is. During the time, some years ago, there's a pastor in Georgia. He's dead now. His name is Bishop Eddie Long. Thank you. And in the last years of his life, a lot of accusations and things like that came out, and his ministry was under attack. Well, a whole bunch of people got up, left the church, and went over to Creflo Dollar's church. And they was trying to join over there. Creflo, you can pull the tape. Creflo gets up in his church and stops everything. He said, all of you all from New Birth that came over here, because your pastor's going through something, I will not accept you as a member. He said, go back to New Birth, because your job is to pray for your pastor until God brings a deliverance. Because if he's been a good pastor all this time and he go through one thing and all of a sudden you abandon him, his mindset was, because you'll do it to me.
Now, y'all got to remember, when people go through things, they learn how people are. Now, before Eddie Long had gone through whatever he went through, whether he was guilty or innocent, ain't none of my business between him and God. Before he went through what he went through, Creflo had experienced abandonment when he had beat his child for acting up and disrespecting him. They called the police and he was arrested and people started leaving his church. Somebody, he had no business putting his hands on that girl. Let me explain something to you. If I raise you in my house and you disrespect me in my house, you gonna get it in my house. And if you don't like the rules of this house, get your own house. I mean that with my soul. In the house that I live in right now, and I got some guest rooms, one or two. If I let somebody live with me, you're not, don't even think about it. It's not going to happen. It's an example. But if I let somebody live with me, I don't care that you're 50, 60, or 70. If I say that the rules of this house, that the doors are going to be locked at 10 o'clock, I don't care that you're grown. You're grown in my house. And everything around here shut down at 10 unless we're at church. Well, come in my house late and the alarm going off, waking me up. Now I can't get back to sleep because you decided to come in at 10:03. It's not going to happen. You're clanking around there, realize that key don't work. Be calling me and I'll have do not disturb on my phone. I'll talk to you in the morning when I wake up. You sit and have a ministry conversation with Bambi and all them other animals that's out there. Be Dr. Doolittle tonight. See, here's the deal. Pray my strength of the Lord. I got to go. Lord have mercy. You get the word today? That rule. And it don't matter, it can be a business, it can be anywhere. I've had people to come to our church and say, well, I don't know why we can't do it because they're my last church. I'll stop it right there. You ain't at your last church. This is like being in a new relationship, talking about in my last relationship. And I ain't got to do with that. I'm not here to pick up where they left off. I got rules. In my last relationship, they was paying for everything. Well, you need to go back there. In this relationship, you're going to have a job. We got to work together. Come and take this microphone, Tiki. They're looking at me mad and strange. Help her up. I can't help her up right now. Help her up. Lord, have mercy. I love y'all.
Come on, let's bless the Lord for our bishop. Oh, you can do better than that. Was that not a sound word? Bless the Lord. Hallelujah. Come on, let's pray for him as he leaves. Father, we thank you for the man of God. We thank you for the deposit that he's left with us. We thank you, God, that it has fallen on good ground and that it's going to spring up into everlasting life. Now, Father, as he goes, continue to strengthen him, God. Heal his body in the name of Jesus, and we'll bless you forever. Amen. Come on, put your hands together one more time. Amen. Let's get ready to give. If you need a credit or debit card slip, just raise your hand. The ushers will be happy to serve you. If you are sowing by Cash App, it is on the screen, $ Monument of Praise. If
you are sowing by PayPal, monumentofpraise.org/give. If you are sowing by Givelify, you are putting Monument of Praise Ministries in the search box, or you're mailing it to 321 Oakview Road, High Point, North Carolina, 27265. And you are sowing your teruma as well, amen. We are blessing the man of God on a continual basis, and he does not take that lightly. He does not take that lightly. He looks and he glories in the fact that you are doing what you're supposed to be doing. As far as your teruma, if you're sowing by Cash App Teruma, it is $ Dr. Kevin A. Williams. And you are sowing by Zelle, Dr. Kevin A. Williams at gmail.com. Amen. The scripture says the laborer is worthy of his hire. That means he's worth what you're sowing. Amen. You can't give enough because you think you're just giving to the man, but God is blessing what you're giving and he's multiplying it so that it can be used in every area that is needed in his life. Amen. There is a blessing in giving. We don't want to be caught not giving. Amen. Amen. Are you done? Are you finished? All right, you're going to pass that offering to the side aisles, and the ushers are going to come down and collect them with the baskets. God is good, isn't he? The evolution of growth. We are always growing. We are always expanding. We are always moving from glory to glory and from strength to strength. He broke that thing down today. How many of you were cut today? I wasn't cut by myself. But the wonderful thing about being cut is that you heal, and that once you heal, you're better than you were. The scar may be there, but it's only a testament of what God has done for you in your life. Amen. Hallelujah. Do we have any visitors today? Do we have anyone visiting with us for the first time? We want to be able to acknowledge you. We see a hand in the back. Amen. Come on, let's bless God for the woman of God in the back. Amen. We thank you for visiting with us today. And we pray that the Lord continues to bless you and strengthen you, and that you will visit us once again. Amen. All right. Is there anyone that is not saved, that has backslidden, that wants to come back to the Lord? We want to extend to you that opportunity today as well. Amen. Come on, repeat after me. Jesus, I thank you for you, for the promise of you. I confess that I am a sinner and I need to be saved. I believe that you died, that you were buried for 3 days, and that after the third day, you rose with all power so that I may have a right to the tree of life. And because of that, right now, I can confess that I am saved. In Jesus' name, amen. Come on, put your hands together for those that made that confession. Amen. Isn't it a wonderful thing to be saved? Saved. Come on, y'all, let's stand up. It's time to go. If you're in the chat and you did make that confession, come on, we want you to put in there, I am saved. Come on, let's repeat it with them. I am saved. Amen. Come on, let's receive praise and worship. I'm sorry, I got to do one more thing. If anybody wants to join the church today before we leave, do we have anybody that wants to join our ministry? Again, we are moving, we are growing, we are accepting every and anyone because we got a lot of work to do, y'all, amen? The harvest is ripe and the laborers, I'm not going to say they're few, I see you. It's time to work. Tell your neighbor it's time to work. Amen. Put your hands together one more time. Let's receive praise and worship.
Amen. As we prepare to go, I'm not going back, I'm moving ahead. I'm here to declare to you, my past is over in you. All things are made new. Surrender my life to Christ. I'm moving, moving, forward. Let's pray. Father, we thank you so much for the word on today. Now bless us as we prepare to leave from this place, but not your presence. Guide us and protect us. It's in your name we pray. Amen. Amen. You are dismissed, Monument. See you at Bible study tomorrow.
And you all, they have fitness tickets in the lobby. If you're purchasing your fitness tickets, they're $5. And again, Saturday at Jerusalem, Queen Esther's Court, the launch is at 2 p.m. on Saturday at Jerusalem.